Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to our service, both here, those who are here and those joining with us online. It is great to be able to worship together and gather as a church family. My name is Andy, one of the pastors here. And just so you are aware, this is the first Sunday where Pastor Mark and his family are on sabbatical. So we'll be thinking and praying for them during this time. But we're thankful that David Barker is with us this morning and a few other Sundays as well. Just before we jump into our time of singing together, I just want to make a couple of announcements. We are having a men's ministry breakfast, which will be taking place on May 11th. So the last day to sign up for that will be on May 5th. So you have a couple weeks to sign up at the info desk back there. It'll be a great morning of eating, fellowshipping, and hearing from God's word. As well, next Saturday, that's April 13th, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. in the chapel, we are having our sensory room and FASD training. So it's for those, first for those who are serving in that room, but it's also open to all who would like to take part in that training. And so we look forward to that and being able to continue to equip ourselves and helping all of our kids who come here. So that's next Saturday at 10 a.m. All right, I think that's all that I will mention for announcements. Jason Colley is going to come and just give one announcement as our Deacon of Facilities.
Good morning. As co-chair, we prefer Party Planning Committee, by the way, Andy. Somewhat also known as Facilities. We have a work day coming up the last Saturday of this month. So in the next, not really sure, what's the date of the last Sunday? Well, you get behind this thing, you become Andy. I have no idea. It's the last Sunday of the month. There's, some food. Are we having food? Entertainment? I'm not sure. So we'll be putting a sign-up sheet out. We have lots of work to do inside and outside. We've got landscaping, but a lot of painting. So if you can just put that date in your calendar. I'd like to have lots of people just so that we can get a lot of things done. Maybe even tackle the flat roof and save some money. So last Saturday of the month. Not sure when it is, but I hope to see you all there. Thanks.
Good morning. As we come out of celebrating Easter last Sunday, I thought for our call to worship, I would read Titus 3, 4 to 7. It said, "But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life." I invite you to stand and join us as we sing this morning.
Come let us worship our King. Come let us bow our knees. He has the great need. Jesus, count for all who mourn. You this morning. It's a joy to be together as a family. And this morning I want to bring to your attention just some of our family needs and that we can pray together and pray for them. Some of the health needs that are prominent this week are Carl and Jan Godfrey. Jan is at home and is recovering, but very slowly. And both Jan and Carl are just tired out with all this stuff. You know what that means. Brad Gardner had an MRI and on his shoulder and is awaiting the report from the MRI and probably surgery. Eunice Moore also has a broken shoulder. And she's at home and waiting for the doctors to report on that too. Evelyn Burlington had surgery, and the result showed low-grade cancer, and which is a wonderful, wonderful report. And so she doesn't require any serious medication, just doctors to watch over it carefully. Luke Johnson. Luke is a young man, the son of a church-planting pastor and his wife in Port Dover. Luke is a little fellow with brain and liver cancer and is not doing well. And so continue to pray for Luke and his mom and dad. Willie Moot is going to be having some injections on her knee sometime in the near future. Donna Pennington is here, right there. Good to see you, Donna. We've been praying for you, and it's great to see you back with us. What a joy to have you walk through the doors one more time. Mike Burnett has a different color hair this morning. And he has a reason for it. Mike's been cancer-free for 6 years. And congratulations, Mike. Praise to our Heavenly Father for that. What a wonderful, wonderful report from him. A couple of other things. Condolences to Rob and Mary Jean Anderson, members of our church. Their Rob's mom, Velma, went to be with the Lord last week. And the funeral was yesterday. And so some of the family need to be remembered. And so concern for them. And pray for Ray, Rob's brother as well. A couple of other things in the church family. Steve McComb leaves for Ethiopia on Wednesday for 3 weeks in a teaching role. The North Africa team leaves on April 12th, that is a Sunday. And the good news is the visas have arrived, which was always a concern. And now it's just a matter of timetable and tickets, etc. Another thing too is, this is the Milligans' 67. Oh, be nice. I will be nice. Congratulations to you both. That's wonderful. You know that we have a program for our children, and they're going to be dismissed in just a moment. But before we do, I think it's time that we took a few minutes to pray together for these folk that we've talked about. Father God, what a joy it is to come into your presence. We've already sensed your presence with us. You've already promised us you would be here. We're so grateful for that. And now some of our friends aren't doing well physically, and the list is long, but Father, you know each one and you know what they need. So we ask, as their family, that you, whatever their needs are, that you'll meet them and meet them in your time and in your will. We're also so grateful, Father, for the ministries that go on here in the church, for the people that faithfully, daily, weekly give of their time and energy to be part of this church ministry. We also thank you, too, for the privilege of having us represented around the world with our missionaries. And wherever they are today, whatever their needs are, whatever their tasks are today, we ask that you be with them, guide and direct them, and keep them well and strong. And, Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have to come into your presence and lay all these things at your feet. You have said to us, cast them all at me. Let me handle them. And so we do that this morning. And we're grateful for your love, your care, and your provision for each one of us. And so we ask all these things in our Savior's name. Amen. Our kids program is about to start. And anybody from grades 1 to 5 can be dismissed. And I ask that as soon as the service is over, you go and pick them up. If you don't, they'll all be given 2 chocolate bars and a free kitten. And so the kids are off now, and we're grateful for those that lead in that. While Pastor Mark is on his sabbatical, it's our joy to have old friends come back to visit with us. David Barker is not unknown to most of us. David came to us in 1996 as our senior pastor and was here till 2005. And then he went back to Heritage as a professor. He has taught many of you. Pastor Mark, he taught you. How did he do? No. We won't go there, David. No. Anyway, it's good. Then David got old and retired. And he is now Professor Emeritus. Is that right? Yeah. David's a Professor Emeritus at Heritage College. He is known as a theologian, as a teacher, as an author, except his books don't have any pictures. But more importantly, David is a man of God. He's an exuberant lover of God's word. You'll catch that. And not only that, he's a friend. So David, we welcome you. Come and minister to us.
And the actual fact is Pastor Mark was a very, very good student. It was a joy to have him and so many of others of you in my classes over the years. It's always a joy to come back and see some of my former students, but also see some of my former parishioners here. And there's a lot of you that I don't recognize, that I don't know. And it's great to see how God is working here in this church under Pastor Mark and the leadership. I'm just so pleased to see what God is doing here. And thank you for the privilege of coming and being part of your world and life for the next number of weeks and months. It was a thrill and a surprise when I got a call from Pastor Mark and asked if I would help out and fill in while he's on sabbatical. We worked very, very hard to make that happen. It's a great joy and a privilege to be here. So thank you. thank you, Paul, for the introduction. I think I thank you for that, but Lorraine is not with me, my wife. She's at home. She got a call last night. She's on granny duty, picking up our grandkids, taking them to church, and that kind of thing. We have a van. It's called the Granny Van, she regularly transports our grandchildren from here, there, and everywhere, wherever they need to go. We've got 14 of them. Her life is full. Hopefully she'll be able to come with me maybe on some of the weeks that I'm here, you'll be able to greet her and say hi to her. So, great privilege for being here. Thank you so much, and we're looking forward to these weeks with you having the opportunity to exposit the scriptures and look for what God is speaking to all of us as we look at the Word of God. Since this past Sunday, and we know it is Easter, we are in the time of Jesus after he was resurrected. Now, before I go any further, somebody already said to me, "You're not preaching out of the Psalms?" And I said, "No, there's another part of the Bible called the New Testament." I've read it a few times. I think I'm going to spend a little time there. So that's a big surprise for a lot of you, because I think some of you don't know that I know about the New Testament, but I have read it. So, but we're in this season after Easter. We call it the post-resurrection period. And we're moving toward the time when Jesus ascended to heaven, and then beyond that, we're moving to Pentecost and the birthday of the church. So Jesus, after Easter, after last Sunday, is on earth for a few weeks yet, and we have several gospel accounts of Jesus' appearances during this time. So we're going to look at some of them for the next 3 weeks. And I'm calling this little series, Seeing Jesus After His Resurrection. And we're going to look at the account where Jesus appears to a couple of disciples on the road to Emmaus. And that's going to be our topic for today. Then next week, I'm going to talk about Jesus appearing to the disciples in the locked room and his commission of them. That will be next week, and that's from the Gospel of John. And then the third week that I'm with you, we're going to talk about the ascension of Christ. And we'll go to the end of the Gospel of Luke, and we'll go to the beginning of Acts. And of course, we know that Luke wrote both his Gospel and the book of Acts. So it's kind of a flowing story from one to the other. So today we start with the appearance of Jesus on the road to Emmaus. Now, if I was to ask you this, here's a question for you. If you had to go back into history to one event that you would just like to be part of, not as a participant, but as an observer. If you would like to go back to one event in history to be there as an observer, what would that event be? All right, think about it. If you had a chance to go back to any event in history and you were there as an observer, what would that event be? Ah-ha-ha. People pretty quickly go to the foot of the cross, right? I told Marla that I was actually going to get you guys to get out your phones, and I would have my phone and text me. Now, first of all, some of you just think, Barker using a phone? This is amazing. I mean, this is miraculous in and of itself. However, I've chosen not to do that, but that's okay. So think about that. So I'm thinking, all right, okay, here's some of the things that maybe some of you might want to have gone back to. For example, for you royalists, maybe you would have wanted to go back to the coronation of Queen Elizabeth I, Queen Elizabeth II, maybe Queen Victoria, okay, for you royalists. For you sports fans, all right, the thing that comes to me is October 23rd, 1993, Sky Dome. Joe Carter's home run, right? Some of us would like to go back to that event, right? For those interested in culture and history, perhaps the first performance of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, May 7th, 1824. When I asked my wife what event she would like to have been there to see, she went to 1867 Charlottetown, July 1st, the beginning of the nation of Canada. Oh, that was interesting. For many of us as Christians, all right, the foot of the cross, right? Obviously, many of us would like to have been at that event. Or maybe at the empty tomb with the women who heard the voice of the angel saying that he is not here, he is risen. Ronald Allen, book The Lord of Song, tells the story of when he was a first-year student in a class in the history of Western civilization. The prof asks this very question. And the question was this: if you could go through a time warp and be an observer, not a participant, in any three events in ancient history, what would those be and why? And he says, my answer was, first, to have hidden in the folds of Moses' cloak when the glory of the Lord passed by on Mount Sinai. Yeah, that would have been something, eh? Wow. Or to have huddled with the women beneath the cross when our Savior died. Or to have walked with the two disciples on the road to Emmaus when the resurrected Lord explained the meaning of the Hebrew Bible. And then he wrote, and if my choice was limited to one, it would be the last. This must have been the most stunning lecture in the history of learning. And I have to admit, I agree. I wish I could have been that third disciple on that road to Emmaus. For over 45 years, I've been buried in the joy of studying this book that we call the Old Testament, and it's 39 books that compose that book, and I am sure I have gotten so much wrong, or incomplete, or I have missed so much. And to think that I could have journeyed with Jesus as he walked along, as he gave an exposition of the law and the prophets, pointing to himself. That must have been amazing. I wish I had been there. Well, the story is told of that walk of Jesus with a couple of disciples in Luke chapter 24. Now, what I want you to do, I want you to close your Bibles. All right, turn off your phones. I simply want to read the story to you. And this is how it was heard in the first century. They did not have Bibles. They didn't have it on PowerPoint. They didn't have it in front of them. The way that the church heard the Gospel of Luke or any of the New Testament or Old Testament for that fact, is in fact by hearing it read, and hearing it read well. So what I would like to do for you this morning is read the story. Papa Dave is going to read you a story from the Bible, and I'm going to read you the story of the road to Emmaus. Here we go. This is the word of the Lord. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened, and as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, and their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know these things that have happened in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. What is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. And they came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. And some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." And he said to them, "How foolish you are, how slow to believe all the prophets that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures. And by the way, that's the Old Testament scriptures, because the New Testament was still being written at this time. All right? All said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And they approached the village to which they were going. And as they did, Jesus continued on as they were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So we went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, listen to this phrase, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." And when the two told what had happened on the way, how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This is the reading of the word, and it is the story of the road to Emmaus in Luke 24. You can open your Bibles now, all right? I'll let you do that. Turn on your phones. You can find it on your phone or whatever device you use in order to get the text in front of you here. So, what I've called this little sermon is a walk, a lecture, a meal. Oh, how I wish I could have been there. And so the question is, what's going on here? Out of the hundreds of stories that Luke could have told about Jesus, out of the dozens of stories that Luke could have told about Jesus after his resurrection, why did he choose this one? Why is it here? Why did God work on his heart and soul in order to pen this story? He could have spoken, written about many, many other things. And so our answer is, of course, a best guess at best. But I submit to you that this story is told by Luke to the church. And that's important to understand. Luke is telling this story to the church of his day, and through the power of the word of God, God breathed, to our day, first century and 21st century, for three reasons, captured in what I see in this story as three scenes. The first one is this, scene one. He writes this story in order for us to know and believe, and by the way, we sang about this, I believe, to know and believe that not only is Jesus resurrected from the dead, but in this post-resurrection appearance, he is actually physically living and physically alive. And that's going to be important in a minute. There's a second scene. After he walks and talks with them, the second scene is he now explains the Old Testament. And so Luke tells the church this story so that they would read their Old Testaments now with Jesus of Nazareth as the focus of all that they read in those 39 books. And then the third reason, I believe, among probably many reasons, is that in that final scene where he eats with them, the disciples see Jesus in a unique way when he took that bread and he broke it and he gave it to them. And we're going to come back to that in a minute as well. So three scenes that we see in this story. They seem to be unrelated and unconnected, But I would argue that Luke is concerned about three critical factors. Three critical factors that the church needs to know about the post-resurrection Jesus. And that the church needs to constantly understand and be informed about in this post-resurrection time and as a post-resurrection church. First century, 21st century. Three reasons captured in three scenes. And the first scene is this. Jesus appears as a normal traveler on the road. All right. So here Jesus comes along, couple of guys walking along. They're rehearsing everything that's going on. They're confused. They're not quite sure what's going on. Jesus has died. They've been told by a couple of women that Jesus is not there. Evidently, it has been confirmed, but they're not quite sure what's going on. Big events, unusual and unexpected events. And then Jesus, unknowing to them, joins them. They are prevented from recognizing him. And they proceed to tell him all about who he is, his life and teachings, his suffering and death, which was brutal for them, his resurrection, and the women who found out about the whole thing. And here's a key point that Luke is making. Luke is making sure that he tells this, as he tells this story, that the readers understand that these two guys actually saw and talked with him and eventually ate with him. And the point is this. Not only is Jesus resurrected from the dead, and we sang about that. Great choice of songs to introduce what we're talking about today. We sang about not only Jesus being resurrected from the dead, but even more so, he is physically alive and well and living among them. Yes, it was more than a resuscitated body. It was a glorified body. He could walk through walls. He could appear and disappear. But the post-resurrection of body of Jesus was real, physical, seeable, touchable, and could eat and enjoy a meal. Tom Holland, in his book Dominion Theology, Making the Making of the Western Mind, says this, that Jesus, over the course of the next 40 days, had appeared to his followers not as a ghost or as a reanimated corpse, but resurrected into a new and glorious form. Now you're saying, wow, okay, what's the point? Well, you got to understand, back in that day, there was coming into being a heresy. That heresy was called Gnosticism. And Gnosticism said that anything physical was sinful, was tainted, was not as good as spiritual. And Luke is saying, not so. The spiritual is not superior to the physical. That we are complete and whole people. We are physically created and we are spiritually created and we are one as persons. And this was leading to a teaching that Jesus' resurrection was only spiritual. That he was resurrected as a ghost. Resurrection as some kind of spiritual animation of some kind. And here's the point. That heresy still exists today. An atheist by the name of Dan Barker caught my attention on that name. Not Dave Barker, just in case you're wondering. and I don't think is a relative of mine. I don't know that. I doubt that he is. Wrote this. It is perfectly consistent within Christian theology to think that the spirit of Jesus, not his body, was awakened from the grave. Wow. Anybody buying into that? As Christians today believe that the spirit of Grandpa has gone to heaven while his body rots in the ground. He says this, the physical body is not important to Christian theology. Ha. Like, anybody okay with this? Wow. And he and others argue that the resurrection and the appearance of Christ were only spiritual, ghostly, apparitional. And we have actually, you know, who I just quoted was an atheist. We actually have Christian scholars who are playing on the edge of this. And here's the point. If this is true, if Christ's resurrection was not a literal physical body, as the Apostle Paul says, our faith is futile, and we of all people are to be most pitied. Let's turn off the lights and go home. Luke is pointing the church then and now, first and 21st century, to a historically risen, physical, walking, talking, eating, glorified, embodied Jesus Christ. And we are called to believe this. And we sang it. I believe. I believe. I believe. And we do. We can quibble a lot about a lot of things in our faith, but we can't quibble about this one. If Jesus Christ is not physically resurrected, our faith is dead. And the Apostle Paul makes that clear in Corinthians, and Luke makes that clear in his story of the road to Emmaus. That's the first scene. But now the story goes on, and Jesus now challenges these two disciples. We move into the second scene where he begins to give an exposition of the Old Testament wrapped around Jesus himself, and he actually calls these two disciples foolish and slow of heart. Well, that's a little harsh, a little intense. But what do we have here? So the second scene is this. The second scene that Jesus explains the Old Testament wrapped around himself. In the book, Stranger in the Woods, I don't know how many of you have ever read that book or seen the movie. In the book, Stranger in the Woods, Michael Finkel tells the true story of a man by the name of Christopher Knight. Chris Knight went into the woods in Maine, USA, and lived as a kind of hermit for 27 years. Alone, in a tent, four seasons of the year. Summer, fall, winter, spring. 27 years hidden in the woods of Maine. He spoke one word to one person in 27 years. It was the word hi to a person he accidentally met in the woods. He was hidden. He was never found. He survived by stealing food, clothing, sleeping bags, and other essentials, blankets, mattresses, propane tanks, from cottages and camps and houses within 3, 5, 10, 20 minutes of his hidden camp. 27 years. Some people's homes were burglarized over 1,000 times. There was a camp for disabled children that he burglarized over 1,000 times. Finally, he was caught robbing that camp. A hermit, isolated, living in the woods, a bushman, never found. But the most startling thing about the man was that everyone fully expected a hermit that was unkempt, unshaven, ragged, a bushman, perhaps even insane. And none of these were true. When they caught him, and they did, they caught him in this camp. He was burglarizing for food, clothing, and that kind of thing in order to survive. He was washed. He was clean shaven. He was well groomed. He was wearing brand new clothes, stolen. And he was anything but mentally broken. He was intelligent. He was thoughtful. And it caught everyone by surprise. Completely unexpected. By the way, if you want to read a second book by the same author, read The Art Thief. A similar kind of story that just is absolutely amazing and shocking when you read the thing and how so much of it is unexpected. But this is exactly the case with Jesus. This one that the Old Testament pointed to was not what they had expected. Look at verses 25 and 26. He said to them, "How foolish you are and how slow to believe all the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. These disciples, along with the Jewish people in general, had their expectations of Messiah, and they were wrong. The Messiah who came was completely unexpected. Suffer? What do you mean, suffer? He's supposed to come as a king. Die? What do you mean, die? And then after that, enter glory? And his teaching changed everything. And two things that Luke is making sure that the church hears Jesus saying is this. Number one, look no further. The Messiah has come. His name is Jesus of Nazareth. And so this ends all speculation about who the ultimate Messiah that the scriptures are speaking to is. He is saying, it is this Jesus of Nazareth. Secondly, he is saying, understand your Old Testament. He is to suffer first and then enter glory. And there's no accident here in the way that you have just told me this story is what he is saying to them. So yes, when we read Isaiah 9:6 and the names of the Messiah, the names the Messiah would have, when we read Isaiah 7:14 and the prophecy of the virgin birth, when we read Micah and the Bethlehem prophesied as the birthplace of Messiah, we also read Isaiah 53. And Isaiah 53 makes it very clear that through suffering, he was to enter into his glory. And he is saying to them, change your expectations. Yes, this Jesus of Nazareth is the Messiah in the Old Testament, the one that was spoken of in the Old Testament, this one that you are talking about, as hard as that is for you to believe. And secondly, suffering was always part of the plan. There is no accident here. And so as we read the Old Testament, we now read it focused on Christ and the sufferings and glory of a resurrected Christ. And this is where I say, oh, I wish I could have been there to hear him explain all that. And by the way, by implication, this means that his people are to be a people of suffering in order to enter glory. All of a sudden, the implications begin to move in our direction. And now the third scene. And we see that rather weird event of Jesus acting if he's going to go on further. He's persuaded not to. But then he does this breaking of bread thing. And what is all that about? So as they approach the village, they urge him to stay with us. Verse 30, and when he was at the table with them, and here's the key phrase, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. What's going on here? What is Jesus doing? We have to ask, what event happened when the same thing happened? Listen to what Luke says two chapters earlier. And he took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. Sound familiar? What's going on here? That two chapters earlier was a recall of the Last Supper where Christ institutes the communion service that we celebrate every month. And look what happened. When he did that, their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us when he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? They then go back and tell the disciples what they have seen, and then the story concludes. Then the two told what happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Three things happened when he took that bread and he broke it, echoing the event that had happened recently at the Last Supper. One, their eyes were opened. Two, their hearts burned inside them. And three, they recognized him. And in that breaking of bread, the recollection of that Last Supper, these three amazing things happened. And Luke is saying to the church, then and now, yes, there's nothing mystical or magical in the bread that we break and eat at our communion services. But there is something unique and special when we engage in that event as the church. That's why we call it an ordinance. Baptists, by the way back in the 18th and 19th centuries, were not afraid to call this thing that we do monthly in our churches, they were not afraid to call it a sacrament. Something sacred. In my own experience, when I celebrate communion, and we will be doing that here while I'm here, I think. Whenever we celebrate communion, you have to know, at least in my own experience, there's something special and unique in that moment of worship and connection with Christ. There's nothing like it in all that we do in the church. Whether it's whether we sing, whether we pray, whether we preach, there's something special about that moment when we celebrate what many churches call Eucharist or communion, the Lord's table. Communion used to be a tack on to church services. I don't know whether anybody remember that. I'm sure you do. My mother hated communion services because the roast would burn in the oven because the sermon went long. And Luke is helping us understand that this is a huge event in the worship life of the church, and I would suggest to you that we profane the name of God when we minimize it. My colleague, Dr. Stan Fowler, who is now silenced by a debilitating stroke, has written a definitive little volume for us Baptists called More Than a Symbol. Everyone needs to read it, okay? Everyone needs to read Dr. Fowler's little book called More Than a Symbol. And he talks about how the communion service is at what many of the churches called Eucharist, based on the Greek word to give thanks, is a special sacred moment in which there is a connection with God that is truly sacred and of the deepest spirituality we can imagine. And he is so right in this manner. And so this third scene recorded by Luke takes the church in his day and hours to that special sacred moment that we celebrate in this church each month. Oh, to be with those disciples for that walk, that lecture, and that meal. And so what do we take away from all of this? First, we have an encounter with God through Jesus Christ. There's an amazing encounter here. We see him alive and living. He's not a ghost or a spirit. He's physically, literally alive, now seated at the right hand of the Father. And our faith and our own resurrection and our hope is based on this foundational note. And Luke wants us to make sure that we know that. We see Jesus, our encounter with Christ. We see him now in a new and fresh way through the scriptures of the Old Testament. We read of what kind of Messiah he is. We read of him in Moses and the prophets. It's all about Jesus. And the third way we experience and we encounter him is that each month, as we celebrate that Eucharist, as we celebrate that communion service, as we break that bread, we drink that cup, we come into a relationship in which our eyes are opened, our hearts burn within us. We recognize him in powerful and unique ways like at no other time. There's amazing good news here. There's good news for us. There's good news for the world. Our faith is rooted in a living, resurrected Messiah, the fulfillment of the Old Testament, and we can engage with him in that powerful, unique way when we celebrate the bread and cup as we do. And we embrace this as good news, and we call on people everywhere to believe, receive, and join us in this good news. But there's challenge here, isn't there? We've just talked about a living, real Jesus Christ. My question to me and to all of us is, how central, how real have we made this real and living Christ in our lives? How central have we made it in our work, our schools, our home, our communities? How real have we made his mission, his morality, his ethics, his call for discipleship? We can talk about a real living Christ. My question is, how real is that real living Christ? How seriously are we taking and reading the God-breathed scriptures that we call our Old Testaments and seeing Jesus in all that we read? How seriously are we taking the bread and cup when we do? Is it truly a sacred moment? May God make it so. So I don't know how all of this is impacting us all here. I know how it's impacting me. And I guess I say at this point simply, let's let the Spirit speak to us. Speak to us through the Word. Speak to us through the presence of the Spirit in our lives. And drive home what needs to be driven home by his supernatural presence and power. Let's just pause for a moment of quiet prayer. And let's each of us ask, what in all the things that we have just talked about is impacting me in a powerful and spiritual way? Just a moment of quiet prayer. Heavenly Father, speak to us by your word, speak to us by your Spirit, and cause us to be shaped in new and fresh ways because of this story and what we have heard. In Christ's name, amen.
Would you stand as we sing in response?
grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe.
As we are dismissed, let's hear these words from Scripture. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you all and go in peace.